One of the tasks that I end up doing over winter is to consolidate and analyze a lot of the records and harvest data that we have collected over the previous season. Although it involves a lot of time working at the computer, I like looking at the details of all of the crops that we grew to get a better understanding about what has been successful and what hasn't worked out quite so well. And with the summarized data that I produce, I can compare the same crops grown in the different gardens and in different years to understand the reasons behind the range of yields from all of the crops that we grew. A lot of this is fairly intuitive in the gardens while we are caring for the plants and harvesting, but I found it very useful to confirm all of this with data once everything is harvested and the crops are cleared. One of the things that I notice is there can be a huge difference in the productivity between the different crops, and if I wanted to grow as much food as possible, it would make sense to focus on growing more of the most productive crops. A quick look at the summary data could provide a simple answer to the question of which of the crops is most productive. But as usual, a more detailed look provides a more nuanced answer that I think is more useful. We try to weigh everything that we harvest from the gardens, recording it all in a spreadsheet that can be filtered out for each individual crop. We also keep track of the amount of space that each crop takes up in the garden so that we can calculate the yield or the weight of the total harvest divided by the area or size of space that it grew in. And with a lot of the crops growing in different gardens and sometimes several batches of the same crop in each garden, there is a lot of summary data to work through. The simplest way to figure out which is the most productive crop is to find the average yield of each type of crop across all the gardens last season. And looking at the information in this way, cucumber and chard were the two most productive crops last year, and nothing else even comes close. Cucumbers really are productive. Given good conditions, they grow quickly and can produce a continual supply to harvest for a lot of the summer and into the autumn. Chard is a very close relative to beetroot, which we grow to harvest the larger outer leaves, and if grown well enough to prevent them from bolting and going to seed, they will continue to produce a reliable supply of leaves for up to a year. There are several different types of chard, but I have found that the Swiss chard type, with the wide white stem and dark green leaves, are to be the most productive over the longest period of time. While cucumbers are very common, and the abundance of the hot part of the season can be pickled and processed for later consumption, chard is not so common or popular. But given its reliability and yield, even throughout the winter here in temperate Ireland, the more we learn to love chard and eat it regularly, the easier it will be to feed ourselves. But that is just the average yields from last year, and comparing them to the average yields from all of the crops over the past 8 years that I have appropriate data for, it's interesting to notice the differences. We seem to be getting better at growing cucumber and chard, or at least able to harvest more on average from these plants. And a few other crops, such as squash, beans, were also better than average this past year, but only slightly, and a lot of crops are essentially the same, even if there is a fair amount of divergence within each type of crop. But a few crops were not as productive this past season. For some, such as turnip, parsnip, rocket or arugula, and kohlrabi, the yield is smaller partly because we've been harvesting the crops earlier to get better quality rather than waiting for a higher yield, which might not be as tender and tasty. In other cases, such as with parsley, we just did not harvest the crop enough last year. But the biggest divergence is with the Swede or rutabaga, mainly because we had a substantial crop failure last year. Comparing average yields over many years, Swede joins cucumber and chard as one of the three most productive crops. And I think it's interesting that a fruiting crop, a root crop, and a crop that we harvest leaves and stems from can all be really productive. Of course, we want to eat a lot more than just these three crops, and a simple way of approaching this would be to grow more crops from one side of this list and give less space in our gardens or fields to crops from the less productive end of the chart, if we want to grow as much food as possible in a given area. And the average yield is a bit misleading, as it includes batches that were really successful and others that did not do well at all. And it also doesn't take into consideration the amount of time that it takes to grow the amount of food that was harvested. Looking at all of the data in a different way, with the yield of each batch of each crop compared to the number of weeks that it was growing, a more complex picture emerges, which I think can give a better understanding of what is going on, if we can filter through all of the details. highlighting the different batches of Swede within this mess of data, there is quite a difference in the range of yields, as well as in the number of weeks that the crops were in the ground, with the highest yield coming from the batches that were growing longest. But these older roots were not great quality when harvested, as they became quite fibrous and in some cases had become rotten inside. I would consider any crop that can produce over 10 kilograms per square meter to be a high yielding crop, but I would not really consider Swede to be one of the most productive crops we've grown, or at least we haven't been able to consistently produce a high yield of good quality roots. The cucumber plants, on the other hand, have produced larger yields in shorter period of time, with a few batches surpassing all the other crops. But these heat-loving plants only grow in the summer and a bit of the autumn, and in Ireland they will only grow in the protection of a polytunnel or greenhouse. We have also been training these vining plants up twine supported from the polytunnel structure, which means that they cause overshadowing and reduce the yield of the crops beside them. If I wanted to make a fair comparison, I should probably divide the weight of the harvested cucumbers by a larger area, which would reduce the calculated yield significantly. So although they're a great crop to grow to take advantage of the heat inside of a polytunnel during the summer, producing a lot of cucumbers to eat fresh or to preserve, I'm not sure that they are the most productive crops that we grow. The chard crops, in comparison, are some of the longest growing crops in the gardens, with the two largest yields from plants that were growing in the polytunnel for more than a year before they started to bolt. But even in the outside gardens, these chard plants can produce quite an impressive yield and are definitely worth growing for their reliability and consistency. But perhaps there are other plants that are significantly more productive in a shorter period of time. Looking at where other crops fit within this cluster of data, tomatoes are another plant that we only grow in the polytunnels and are consistently productive but long-growing plants. They're one of the few crops where it makes a significant difference when comparing the amount of time from sowing the seed to harvesting the last tomato to the amount of time that the plants are actually occupying the bed in the polytunnel. Subtracting the weeks that the plants were growing in pots shows that they can be quite productive in a reduced period of time, but they also overshadow other crops quite a bit. The closely related peppers and aubergine or eggplant haven't been as productive, but we're working on that. The climbing beans inside the polytunnels and runner beans in the outside gardens can be quite productive, but the yield should be probably adjusted down a bit to account for their overshadowing nature. The other beans and pea crops are all relatively lower yielding, even if they are very desirable plants to grow in a vegetable garden. And the squash plant that we grew up a trellis in the polytunnel last year produced a huge harvest, much bigger than any other squash crop we've grown, but it also caused substantial overshadowing, so the kilograms per square meter should be adjusted down quite a bit. The related courgettes or zucchini can also produce a lot, especially the plants that we've been able to keep alive in the polytunnel. But because we tend to harvest them quite young, these plants don't produce the huge yields that they could have if we let them develop into marrows. Looking at the wide range of leafy brassica crops, there are a few types of cabbages that we've been able to grow very large yields of in a relatively short period of time. But most cabbages, as well as the Brussels sprouts and kales, produce a relatively low yield over a long growing season. And the broccoli and cauliflower crops tend to be even lower yielding. Carrots and parsnips can produce impressive yields if left to grow for the full season. But we have found that beetroot can be a lot more productive in a shorter period of time, especially because we tend to eat the full plant, roots, leaves, and stems, which substantially increases the yield of the young plants. Potato plants can also produce a lot to eat, and we've grown very impressive crops of onions, but neither of these are really in the running for the most productive crop. Leeks and garlic and a range of herbs can be very valuable crops, but they do not produce a lot of kilograms to eat compared to the area that they take up and the time that they take to grow. The wide range of leafy salad greens can be quite productive over the long stretch of winter months in the polytunnel and can produce a quick crop in a very short period of time, especially in the spring. And by growing a succession of leafy salad crops like this and other quick crops like radishes, a huge yield can be produced over the full season from the same bed or section of the garden. But it is a salad turnip, or Japanese turnip as we call them, that really stand out. These are a very fast-growing plant of a hybrid variety of turnip, which can produce a surprisingly high yield within 2 or 3 months after sowing the seeds. The highest yields we've been able to produce come from plants grown in the spring in the polytunnel. but they also produce really well in the outside gardens if the pests like flea beetle can be kept away. And like the young beetroot plants, we include both the tender roots and the edible stems and leaves in the yield calculations. So, in trying to figure out which are the most productive crops that we grow, I think it comes down to a choice between the quick-growing turnip and the more continually productive chard plants. This hybrid variety of turnip is easily the highest yielding in the shortest period of time, but only if we eat the full plant. And if we eat the full plant, it significantly broadens the nutrition that we can get from this crop. But there are definite benefits from a crop like chard, where we can sow once and harvest over a long period of time from hardy plants that generally don't have any issues with pests and diseases. And with some shelter from the damaging winds, either with a polytunnel or some other form of protection in the outside gardens, both of these plants can provide valuable greens to eat throughout the winter. While the turnip and cucumbers need to be harvested over a relatively short period of time to get the best quality, the leaves of the chard plants can be left for quite a long time, making the timing of harvesting much more flexible. And that is probably one of the key reasons why they've been a staple crop in our gardens for many years. We are currently harvesting from a crop that was direct sown into the side bed of one of the polytunnels last June after an early crop of potatoes was dug out. We started harvesting leaves from these plants at the end of July and continued to harvest throughout the autumn and into the winter, though the growth definitely slowed down with the cold weather and the lower light levels. But in the last few weeks, the plants started growing really quickly again, with huge amounts available to be harvested. So far, we've harvested 90 kilograms from this 3.2 square meter bed, which translates into a yield of over 28 kilograms of high quality leaves and stems per square meter, and there is still a lot more to harvest. The plants look like they may be starting to transition into producing a large seed stock, and although the leaves can still be harvested for a while after this happens, the yield and quality definitely drops off. But there is probably still a few more weeks of harvesting left, and this one batch of plants will probably become one of the most productive crops we've ever grown. And if we learn to love chard as well as turnip, and we eat it very regularly, then it will become significantly easier to feed ourselves and a lot of other people.